Yesterday, we also recorded the rings in profile against the, in silhouette, against the atmosphere of Uranus, and here are the results. Again, we see the epsilon ring and the delta. Now, see how difficult the gamma ring is to see. On the previous image, it showed up very nicely, certainly easily as well seen as the diffuse eta ring, but here it's very difficult to see. I can see it. Can it be seen in the... fine. What that's telling us, it's got to be very, very narrow. So it shines brightly when we see it in backscattered light, but when we look at it against the disk of the planet, we can see it very only with difficulty, and that says it's very narrow. Here is the beta and the alpha ring. And then down just near the bottom are the 4, 5, and 6 rings, and they are difficult to see, and if you could see them better, you would notice that the spacing of these rings is not the same as it was seen in the full-on view. And the reason for that is that those rings have small inclinations to them, and Jeff Cuzzy put together a cartoon to show why this is the case. Here we are. This is the view that we had, seeing the rings in silhouette against the illuminated side of the planet. If all the rings were in the same plane, their projections against the disk of the planet would be in to the same proportion as we saw them when we were looking straight in. But they have small inclinations, greatly exaggerated here, I should say. And of course, when they're out in different, slightly different planes, that changes the projection geometry, and so it changes the relative separation as you see them in projection. So we have a great deal of optical leverage in these images, and it should permit us to make some rather nice determinations with great precision of the inclinations of these rings. The next speaker will be Larry Soderblom, who is deputy team leader for the imaging experiment.
We're moving into the phase of the mission in which we are just beginning to receive the highest quality observations of the large or major Uranian satellites. I feel a little set up by Brad over the last few days. All I guess I have to say is I'm really only the second Billy Goat Gruff. There's got to be a bigger Billy Goat Gruff coming along to tell you the real answer. So, if I can have the first slide, I'll review briefly a couple of things just to give you an overview and put things in perspective. The major satellites of Uranus fall into three classes. They are about the outer two, Titania and Oberon, are about the same size as Rhea and Iapetus, about 1,600 kilometers in diameter. Ariel and Umbriel form a pair in size. It turns out that our observations are showing they're much closer in size than portrayed here from the earlier observation, something like 1,200 kilometers in diameter. Miranda is about 500 kilometers in diameter. And as you know, our best observations that are coming back today will be of Miranda, Ariel, and Titania, so we'll get a chance to look at close up at a member of each of these three classes. Already, as Brad has pointed out earlier, these objects are beginning to develop some unique characteristics among themselves. This is the real enigma in the system right now. That is Umbriel. Why is it so bland and so free of what we are finding out to be, at least in part, rays from impact craters on at least three of these objects that we've begun to see at closer hand? So Umbriel, as we approach closer, continues to show very little contrast. As a matter of fact, this is stretched up in what you're looking at the noise, basically, in the at the limit of the capabilities of the camera, and still no features are showing up in contrast over most of Umbriel. However, you do see a feature here, kind of a white donut-shaped patch on the surface, so there is at least one kind of albedo marking that we're seeing popping up. Somehow, this very bland pattern, free of any albedo markings, and these white donuts may be related in the story that explains by the whoever the explainer will be why the lack of contrast. Either the material is being painted on the surface, or the surface material is being changed in its properties by some process rapidly enough to erase crater scars and rays, or they are not forming at all. How could they not form at all? That would require that umbriel would be uniform in its composition to a fairly great depth. The very early images we're getting, we'll get better images from the VU BEST sequence that'll come back later today, is showing that there is topography on umbriel. And we will be looking at this region of the object at closest approach. And so we'll be looking for any evidence for material being brought up to the surface by impact gardening. We'll also be looking to see if there are more than one terrain type. It would seem unusual that if umbriel were uniform in its chemical properties through and through, that it would be would show distinctive terrain types. In other words, internal processing is likely to be associated with any kind of resurfacing, and should generate materials of different contrast. Moving on to Titania, this is a color image. All of the satellites are kind of a neutral, slightly brown, brownish-gray color. And high-resolution views will be along this region in which you're seeing the terminator. Or in addition to impact craters, we are seeing definite evidence of internal processes which are producing extension of the crust. These are robin-like features in which expansion or extension tension across this region has caused the faulting. The material, this brightish material here, is almost certainly some kind of bright material such as frost. It's not simply due to illumination of a scarp along here. As a matter of fact, you can see as the bright marking along this scarp turns toward the sun, its contrast doesn't diminish. We've also seen this feature rotated around on the other side of the disk in which it shows the same contrast. So some sort of material is leaking out of fractures and perhaps freezing onto the surface. A big structure up here is reminiscent of the large impact structures we saw in Tethys and Mimas. It's highly collapsed, appears to be a what might be a central depression here. And again, our high-resolution views will be in this region today. We have received our highest resolution images of Oberon. And this is an early color composite. And I'll point out a few things in this view. There's a large mountain here on the limb of Oberon. Stands up quite a distance. And a lot of cratered topography along the terminator here. To bring that up, this is a view of Oberon's terminator in which you can see the very rough overlapping crater forms there. But the surprise, I think, is the materials that we're finding in the floors of some of the large craters, particularly out in the higher sun regions where the sun is shining, such that albedo patterns dominate topographic forms. These materials look to us very much like they had to be deposited in these craters at some time, likely considerably later than the craters were formed. In other words, these craters were formed during a bombardment phase in which the crating rate was very high. So had these materials been generated at that point in time, it's unlikely they would have survived the contemporaneous bombardment that would have gone on.
Welcome back to the York Mills Studios, Rogers Cable TV. This special edition of Astronomy Toronto continues. That was a press conference, a briefing at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory at Pasadena, California, taped at 1 p.m. this afternoon, so some of the latest photos at that time. Some of the project scientists, Brad Smith and Larry Soderblom, going over what you probably saw on the news at 6:30 tonight. Well, what we're going to do now is continue on looking at some of the latest views of Uranus, but mainly the moons of Uranus, because those are the pictures that came in between 4 o'clock and pretty well when we came onto air this evening at 8 o'clock. First thing that we'd like to look at is the rings. The rings and what holds the rings in place. Earlier we looked at moons which travel inside and outside of the little ringlets, which the scientists have called shepherding moons. Basically because they just keep the ring material, it's not a solid material, it's individual particles, they somehow keep the material in place over literally billions and billions of years. If these small moons were not doing that, then the rings would be long gone. So something has to be holding that material into the special ringlets. We've got a videotape segment coming up. One of the Voyager scientists will be talking about these ringlets, what we hope to find.
Exciting new Voyager 2 discoveries at Uranus. Two shepherding satellites at the planet's outer epsilon ring. It's a 15-second exposure taken some 4 million miles away. According to imaging team member Jeff Cuzzy, the satellites are moving at a rate of approximately 5 miles per second, performing some important gravitational work along the ring.
You can see by their configuration that they act like it was suggested at Saturn, like sheepdogs or shepherds, to confine this unruly flock of ring particles from spreading out in all directions.
Would there just be two within the realm of that outside ring?
Well, there may very well be more. As we looked at the images coming down, we all had suspicions of little blips and streaks. There could be other things. And this Uranus system could be very full of junk. For instance, you know that outside of the ring, the main of the ring system in the satellite area, there have been 7 new satellites discovered. And we anticipate finding maybe another 10 or so, you know, within the rings themselves.
The Shepherd satellites are approximately 20 to 30 kilometers in diameter, only one-half to one-third the size of the newly discovered satellites outside the rings.
Why is it the satellites appear long and slanted in the image?
It's slanted because of the motion of the satellite itself, which is about 5 miles per second around Uranus. You can see this star here is smeared less. That's just the motion of the spacecraft. So that's how we tell the difference between a star and a satellite. And the way we know where the stars are is by the navigation team on Voyager has done some very nice work on predicting the location of all the stars that are in each frame. And they can go and very exactly calculate where the camera's pointing and what star we're looking at. So we can actually compare, you know, and measure, in fact, the velocity of the satellite in its orbit.
Voyager 2's cameras will take a closer look at the rings and their satellites toward close encounter.
We have a set of observations which has even higher resolution on the rings than these by another factor of 3 or 4. But and they look something like this, where the camera frame is stepped across the rings in this sort of fashion. Now, unfortunately, because of time constraints, and everybody else wants to look at other things at this time too, we only have about half of the ring covered. That means we'll take this little patch of 6 and then do it again here, again here, again here, again here.
So we may miss satellites in between.
Right, there are gaps. So it's a bet that you've got to take. But if there are 10 or so satellites, then on the average, we should be able to get 5.
Interesting, Jeff. It's now assumed that the satellites, rings, and their Shepherd satellites were all created at the same time the planet was created. And as we further study these phenomena, we'll undoubtedly learn a great deal more about the formation of our entire solar system.
Well, I'd just like to point out that that last little video item was a bit snowy, but that's because we picked it up today, and when it snows outside, sometimes the satellite reception isn't all that hot. Now, an interesting fact is that there is a University of Toronto astronomer, Dr. Scott Tremaine, who's also the director of the Canadian Institute of Theoretical Astrophysics, which is a relatively new institution here in Toronto, has, with some colleagues, created a theory about what we would expect to see with regard to shepherding satellites. And we've got Scott on the phone. Scott, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Hi, how are you?
Fine.
Tell us a bit about the theory that you and your colleagues have postulated about the shepherding moons in orbit around Uranus.
Well, the theory has to do with provides a way of maintaining the rings around Uranus. The most interesting feature of the Uranian rings is that they're so narrow. Although their circumference is about 300,000 kilometers, the narrowest of the rings is only a couple of kilometers across. And that's very hard to understand because the ring particles are constantly bumping and jostling each other, and that inevitably causes the rings to spread. And it's pretty easy to show that without some mechanism for confining the rings would by now, over the lifetime of the solar system, have spread out so much that you'd have a single broad ring rather than those nine very narrow, well-defined rings. We tried for a long time to think of possible mechanisms to keep the rings narrow, and the only way that we were able to come up with was the idea that there were, at that time, undiscovered small satellites on either side of the rings. And the gravitational tug from the satellites, as they orbited past the ring particles, was constantly pushing the ring particles back into a narrow, well-defined ring.
So at what point have you found any results coming back from Voyager at this point?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question, please?
Have you found any of these moons that you think are there?
Oh, yes. Voyager has discovered two moons on either side of the largest, broadest ring, the Epsilon ring. The two moons are orbiting on either side of the ring about 1,000 kilometers away, and it looks very much like those are precisely the rings that we thought were necessary in order to keep that ring in place.
Any questions?
What about the other rings, Scott? We haven't seen any results back here that indicate you found shepherding moons for those.
Yeah, but that's not really a problem. The most important, one of the things that Voyager discovered is that the reflectivity of all of the inner moons is very low. It's only a few percent. And even before the Voyager went by, and even assuming that the moons were reflective, there was a real question whether or not the resolution of the Voyager cameras would be good enough to be able to find the moons. Once we discovered that the inner moons had very low reflectivity, more than a factor of 10 lower than they might have had, there was a real question whether they'd find any moons at all. The two Shepherd moons that they did find were almost certainly the largest ones. The expected sizes we think the other ones might have are as much as a factor of 10 smaller, perhaps only 1 or 2 kilometers across. And if they're that small, it's most unlikely that Voyager will be able to see them.
I see. Scott, there. I heard in the press conference some indications that the rings are not all in the same plane. Is that going to be offer some theoretical difficulties?
No, in fact, the fact that the rings are not all precisely in the same plane was already known from ground-based observations of occultations of stars by the rings. So although the Voyager observations potentially will offer the chance of determining those inclinations more accurately than could be done from the ground, that's not a new discovery. Also, it seems to be very likely that one of the influences of the Shepherd satellites is that they can excite inclinations in the rings. And so the discovery of the inclinations in the rings is at least indirectly a confirmation of the idea that Shepherd satellites ought to be there.
Okay. We heard that there was a new ring discovered today, and if I heard the story right, it's in the same orbit as one of the satellites. Is that correct?
That may be correct, although it's not quite clear. It's certainly true that it appears that the distance of that ring from the planet is close to the distance that one of the Shepherd satellites was found at. However, we don't know yet what the orbit of that Shepherd is. It may be an eccentric orbit, so that the Shepherd is moving in and out. But it is true that that one ring is close to where the Shepard was discovered. That's similar to a phenomenon that was seen at Saturn in the Encke gap, one of the large gaps in the rings that's visible from Earth. There appears to be a satellite there as well as one of these very narrow, faint rings. So it may be a common phenomenon, although we don't really have enough examples yet to be sure.
Scott, you've also worked on Shepard satellites around the rings of Saturn. Is that not correct?
Well, in fact, the original work that we did was in order to explain the narrow rings around Uranus, and we concentrated on Uranus because that was before the Voyager encounter, and we had no idea at the time that Saturn had any narrow rings at all. And so it was with surprise, and I have to say some delight, that we learned that Saturn did in fact have some narrow rings, and that the kinds of Shepard satellites that we felt had to be present around Uranus were also present at Saturn.
Well, you're talking to us from JPL at Pasadena in California, isn't that correct?
Yes, that's right.
What is the feeling there this afternoon or over the past few days? What's it like being there?
Well, it's a little hard to describe. The place is really something like a gigantic zoo because there's a lot of pressure on people to take a quick look at the results, to make some interesting discoveries and to present them to the press and to their colleagues as rapidly as possible. I think everybody is elated that the spacecraft has worked so well and that it's brought back so many really remarkable pictures. And I think everyone is just extremely pleased and happy and probably also very tired.
You're having fun, in other words.
Oh, yes, it's great fun.
So over the next few days, as these pictures come in, you still feel that there is a possibility we may be able to pick up some of these smaller shepherding moons at the limit of, say, the Voyager's resolution?
Well, I certainly hope so. The pictures that were taken before closest encounter have not yet all been processed, and there's another sequence of ring pictures coming back tomorrow, I believe, that are potentially very good for looking for Shepherds. I think it's still an open question whether any more Shepherds will be discovered. There was just one new satellite, in fact, announced today, so I think there's still some chance that one or two more will show up. But as I say, I think that although finding extra Shepherds will be very helpful to us in understanding the details of the ring system, I'm already confident that the discovery of Shepherds by Voyager at Saturn and the discovery of two more here at Uranus shows that the basic physics of the process is almost certainly what's controlling the rings around Uranus.
Well, that's great. Congratulations, and thanks very much for talking to us today.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
He made an interesting point that I think we should talk about, and that is at these zoos, to quote Dr. Tremaine, there is a real call for instant science, but that's not the way science works, is it?
Well, it is, except you're not used to doing it out in public like this. I think that's the big difference. I think we all, when we get new results, sit down and talk about it with our colleagues about this and try out ideas, often very dumb ideas, which are thrown out, and it's part of the process of working out what's going on. And they're doing the same thing out there, except they're forced to do it out in public. And the difficulty with that is that because there will be so much public interest in this kind of thing, probably the only thing that most people will remember about the work these scientists are doing are the half-baked ideas that they have right now. And a few weeks from now, when they have more data, they've had more time to sleep, to think, to talk to colleagues, the ideas will probably be quite different, much more mature. They'll get published in the scientific literature, and the average guy in the street will never hear about them.
The theories we're going to be hearing are probably the theories that are going to be in the newspaper tomorrow or next 3 days, and someone will be describing some feature or moon as some kind of a thing. But more analysis of the information will show there's something else there.
The interesting thing, too, is today they said, one of the scientists was asked this, and he said, well, you know, I just finished a paper on Saturn's rings. I mean, he has spent the last 5 years working on the data that came in from Voyager. And every now and then, in Houston, geologists meet to discuss the findings from the moon rocks.
That's right.
We're still working on lunar samples.
In the last couple of years, there have been some dramatic new results from the Apollo lunar missions that have completely changed our ideas about how the moon formed.
In what way?
Well, they suggest now that it's quite possible that the moon was formed by a giant impact on the Earth, which sprayed material out into space, and that material then collected together to form the moon. And a lot of the impetus for that idea has come from reanalysis and rethinking about moon rocks that were brought back 10 and 12 years ago.
It's amazing. All right, it's about time that we went to the latest pictures from Uranus. First thing I'd like to do is invite everyone to take a look at these. We've got a videotape in a few minutes. We do invite you now to give us a call. The phone number will be coming up on your screen in a moment. The number we have is 445-5580. We'd like to hear what you have to say about Uranus. And in a minute, we're going to take a look at some of the latest video pictures that came in about 3 or 4 hours ago. Just before we go to this, what we're seeing here is our raw pictures, or what we've been talking about, came right down from this afternoon. They are going to be shocking. They shocked all of us, the details that we were able to see on the moons of Uranus, especially one moon. Its name is Miranda. Voyager 2 went so close. It's the closest moon that Voyager 2 has ever passed by, closer than any of the moons at Jupiter, any of the moons at Saturn. And when we bring up this videotape, you'll see some of these pictures of Miranda and the other pictures that we were coming in today.
Yeah, the detail we're going to see on Miranda is just incredible.
Here we go. That's Miranda. That is a moon of Uranus, and
it's the closest moon to the planet. It was a known moon.
And it's one of the small ones. And
it's only 310 miles across. It's not very big at all.
Yeah,
this is a ring picture. Here again is one of the moons. I don't think that's Miranda. We're beginning to lose track. Somebody should put big signs on these moons saying, I'm Miranda, I'm Titania. That is the chevron, so that...
Yeah, that's Miranda.
That's Miranda. There's a close-up of that chevron. And look, it's a lumpy world. It's not a round world. It's not jagged like Hyperion, but look at the striations in that.
It's not big enough to smooth out the variations in surface height with its own gravity. But what's shocking about these pictures that we're going to see is that there is so much variation in the kind of terrain. Perhaps naively, I expected that these were going to be rather bland, uninteresting ice balls with crater marks on them.
Mm-hmm.
But there's clear evidence of dramatic surface evolution of this very small body, which couldn't possibly have been big enough to have done it with its own internal heat. There must be some external process that acted on this to shape the surface. And the effects are truly dramatic. We'll see areas where material is flooded out from the interior of the planet and smoothed off flooded craters. We'll see cracks on the surface.
There's a big one right there.
Yeah, a big one there.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's Miranda.
That can't be Miranda.
Yeah, no, I think that might be Titania.
Almost too smooth.
Yeah. Yeah, that one is so smooth. I think that's Titania. So those look like what are called grabens, which are areas where the crust has spread apart and dropped down a block.
Like a rift valley in a way?
A rift valley is exactly what a graben is. Or some of the rills on the moon are graben-like features. So it looks like something has caused that surface to expand. This is Miranda. And this is an area on one side of the planet where it almost looks like a surface layer of ice has been stripped off because it's lower than the surroundings. And then you see this darker material exposed, which may be carbon rich. I don't know. We can only speculate on that at this point. But it's quite a dramatic structure. On the opposite limb of the planet, I think we'll have a picture come up before long that shows even more dramatic structure.
It's really incredible.
This is a marvelous picture.
Yeah. You can see clear boundaries between crater areas and these black regions. It looks like the black regions are lower. You can see on the lower left there how the black region is lower than the brighter regions lots of fracturing of the surface. Looks like there's been tremendous geological or tectonic activity shaping the surface of this very tiny body, and it's really hard to understand how that could be.
And those pictures came in around dinner time tonight. That's how new they are.
Really incredible pictures.
Now, can we tell from just these pictures to determine what these things are made of? Like, how can we tell that it's made of water ice?
Well, you tell from the density of the body. Water ice has a density of about a gram per cubic centimeter. You measure the mass and the radius of the body, and a density comes out of that. And they are apparently are basically water ice bodies with maybe a little contamination of heavier elements.
Okay, we'll go to the phone. Good evening. Thanks for phoning.
Good evening.
How are you doing?
Not too bad, thank you. How are you?
What do you think of those pictures?
I think they're wonderful. I think the whole thing is wonderful.
What can we do for you?
I was just wondering if the gentleman on the panel could give me any information as to when there are any more probes planned anytime in the future for this region of space, and what the possibility of perhaps someday a manned mission going up there might be.
Well, I think probably the next thing that we're going to be hearing about as far as the outer planets are concerned is when Voyager 2 travels on to the planet Neptune.
Same spacecraft.
Mm-hmm. And it's going to get catapulted out from, it's getting gravitational toss, shall we say, from Uranus. It's going to be reaching Neptune in August of 1989. So just a couple of years down the road. And we're expecting to get some exciting information at that time about that giant planet. There's no plans for a spacecraft to go to Pluto, and in fact, it'll probably be a long, long time before another spacecraft goes out to Uranus or Neptune. Our next major mission is going to be in May, this coming May, when the Galileo spacecraft is launched from the Earth towards a rendezvous with the planet Jupiter 2 years down the road.
Right. I have another question for you. With the discovery of all of these new moons, I'm wondering if any thought has been given to what they're going to be named, and whether or not they're planning to exhaust the dramatis personae of Shakespeare's Tempest to finish off naming the moons, or what.
Well, there was some thought of calling it Herschel, but they already said there might be a Herschel crater on the moon. They don't want to have too many Herschels around the solar system.
Yeah, the International Astronomical Union has a commission or a committee that spends full time naming these features on bodies and naming new moons, and I'm sure that they will be quite busy over the next couple of years getting to that job.
Possibly boning up on their Shakespeare.
Could be.
Very likely.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye.
Good evening, thanks for calling. Hello.
I'm curious if these pictures that you're showing us come directly to you from Voyager, or whether they're relayed from NASA.
Oh, they're from NASA. No, we never said they were right from Voyager to us.
And I'm wondering, what sort of technology do you have in Toronto to get these pictures from NASA? Roughly, how does it work?
We've been very fortunate enough to acquire a satellite dish to point at one of the American communication satellites of which NASA has a channel. And theoretically, any backyard receiver can pick up this signal. It's a service of NASA, and it's been up there for several years.
You just need one of these special satellite dishes.
Right, and just point it in the right direction.
Okay, thanks very much.
All right, bye-bye. That's a good point. I'm glad he asked
that. That's a good point.
Because I don't have $600 million to send a Voyager. Good evening. Thanks for calling.
All right, I've got a couple of questions as well.
Right.
I'm not quite sure how the Viking photographs, is it like a sonar that returns depth charges, that sort of thing?
The photographs?
Yeah, how does it actually take a picture? It's not a film. It's not a negative.
No, it's a television camera, basically.
It's a television camera.
As we said earlier, it just takes a picture, breaks it down into little parts, gives that a certain brightness, changes that into a number, changes that into electrical impulse, sends it by radio waves, and then once we get it on the Earth, they just do it in the opposite direction, opposite manner.
That makes sense. Thanks. But why, if Galileo is going to be going and doing more intense work and landing on the planet, that sort of thing, why this mission? Is it the goals different than Galileo's?
Well, the Voyager is a flyby mission of Uranus. The Galileo mission, launched towards Jupiter, is going to go into orbit around Jupiter.
Oh, I'm sorry.
About 2 years studying the moons and the planet itself.
Now, Galileo is basically following up on the discoveries of Voyager and trying to answer some of the questions that were raised by those results.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Interesting thing, too, is Voyager was launched in 1977, so it must have been on the drawing board in 73, 74. So this is 1973 technology out at Uranus. What if we could send 1986 technology out there now? Just, and the pictures would just be incredible. The results would be unreal.
Actually, I think the lead time for these missions is longer than that.
So we're looking at early 70s?
Yeah, it's 1970 technology, really.
Good evening. Thanks for phoning.
Good evening.
Hello.
Hello. My question to you is basically this. What is, well, there are really two of them. When Herschel discovered the planet, was he working with Bode's law, or did he just discover it accidentally? My second question is, what is the density of the main satellites?
All right, let's just look at the first question first.
Okay, well...
What's Bode's law? I know what it is, but I bet you don't.
Well, Bode's law is a numerical relationship, which was studied by two different astronomers, mathematicians, about 200 years ago, and they noticed that there was a relationship between numbers that you could take, and it turns out these would give you the ratio of the distances of the various planets from the sun. Really, in terms of Herschel was a very, very good observer. And at the time that he was observing, most of the professional astronomers were more interested in navigation and where the positions of stars were in the sky. Herschel was a very, very good telescope maker. And when he built his telescopes, he built them so that there were very, very good quality images were being produced. And when he scanned through the sky and looked at the stars, he came across this one object which looked definitely non-stellar in shape, and he thought that it might be a comet. And then it wasn't until over the next couple of days and weeks and months, they noticed this object was moving. And then they went ahead and they calculated an orbit for it from their observations and concluded this was not the orbit of a comet, it's more like the orbit of a planet. And so we have another planet.
So it was mainly an accident. He didn't calculate where to look. And
basically,
look.
It's an accident. I suppose it's serendipity, I guess.
Right.
That's right.
And did you have a quick second question?
Yes. What is the density of the satellites of Uranus that show the cratering and the rills and so-called and gravens, possibly? Are they all in the water ice area, or are they more than that? Are they rocky or just solid ice?
Well, I haven't heard numbers announced, but the best values I know of put them around 1 to 1.5 grams per cubic centimeter, which would be ice, yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Good evening. Hello, good evening, and welcome to Astronomy Toronto.
Good evening. Enjoying your show very much.
Great.
My first question was, is there a reason that you cannot see a picture of the rings as well as the planet at the same time, or is that accidentally or just the way the cameras were aimed, or what?
No, I think the problem is that the planet is so much brighter than the rings that they want to make sure that they're not pointing at the two things at the same time, or you won't be able to see the rings. Also, for the pictures that we've been seeing, the satellite is so close to the planet that it just doesn't have wide enough angle lens to see them both at the same time.
Uh-huh. But the rings are very faint. In comparison to the planet.
They're very faint. The planet reflects about 50% of the light that falls on it, and the rings reflect about 3% of the light that falls on it. And there's a lot more surface area on the planet to reflect light, so it completely overwhelms the rings.
Uh-huh. The other question was more of a general nature. As both Voyagers go out of the solar system, are they left on, sort of monitoring, and is there a possibility they might see another planet which has at some time been postulated to be somewhere out there?
Well, the spacecraft will probably keep on, I guess their power is going to keep them going for maybe, I don't know, 50, 100 years, so I can't remember now the
certainly
time
past
period.
Neptune.
Certainly past Neptune. Extensive searches have been made beyond the orbit of Neptune for planet-sized objects. Since 1930, when Pluto was discovered, there have been extensive searches made, and I think the estimate or a figure that I saw at some time, if you extended the volume of space at about 10 times or 100 times the distance of Pluto from the Sun, and we've not found any evidence of even an Earth-size object sitting in that
object. Well, is that gravitational evidence or observational evidence?
That's photographic evidence.
Photographic evidence.
You're working on the basis that you have an object that's out there of a certain size, and maybe you make certain ideas, guess with how much light it might be reflecting from the sun, so therefore how bright it might be. And then you go ahead and you take photographs of different areas of the sky over a period of time, and then you compare these photographs to see if you're picking up any faint object which is moving. But
what about on the basis of variation in Pluto's orbit, or in the same way as Pluto was discovered, in a sense?
Well, one of the things that they're trying to do with the Voyager spacecraft, and also with the two Pioneer spacecraft, is study their motions. Based on our knowledge of what is out there in the outer solar system, which is not very much, we're looking to see if these spacecraft deviate from their path in any way, and if there's another mass out there, then these spacecraft their position might change. Might be able to get an estimate of actually how where another planetary body might be.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Okay. One point we should make quickly is the Voyager spacecraft is not a well spacecraft, and they're not going to use it any more than they need. They have to. It's basically past its lifetime, and I believe up until February 25th they'll be working on Uranus, and then they'll shut it down for 3 years, 3.5 years, okay, until they reach Neptune.
Well, it's not completely shut down, though, Randy. It's being used. Some of the instruments are being used to observe stars.
All right, but I mean, they're not looking around for other planets.
No, they're not looking around, but they are. There are some things,
sure,
some science going on in the long voyage.
Well, they're interested in like the solar wind and things like that.
Solar wind, and they have an ultraviolet instrument on there, which is not duplicated in any Earth orbit. Satellite, and it's being used to observe variable stars.
Oh, really?
Out. Yeah.
Very, super. Good evening. Thanks for phoning.
Thank you. I wanted to let you know how much I've been enjoying the program.
Oh, great. What can we do for you tonight?
Well, I was wondering just what techniques are being used to determine the gases in the various planetary atmospheres and on the on the moons. Is it the spectrophotometry or what?
Yes, it is spectrophotometry. There are no gases, as far as we know, on the moons of Uranus, and we don't expect any. They're not massive enough to hold gas, but the atmospheres are being observed spectrophotometrically, and that will tell us what elements are there, what molecules. There's also some indirect techniques, this process that was mentioned earlier, where radio waves are sent back through the rings. Those radio waves are also sent through the atmosphere of the planet, and the way in which the radio signal varies as it's cut off as the satellite goes behind the planet is allows you to measure the densities at different levels in the atmosphere, and that can be used with the spectrophotometric information to give reasonably precise information on the composition of the atmosphere.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Good evening. Thanks for phoning.
Hi. Now that we've seen close up the moons of Saturn, Jupiter, and Uranus, it's interesting to note that the surface geography of the moon seem to be quite similar. Given the difference in the composition of the planets as we understand it now, do you have any thoughts on this, that the moons would seem to be so similar given this difference in the planet structure?
Well, they're... Let me see. I suppose the first thing I would say about the moons, they're all very distinctive. I think if you came along and showed a group of pictures to a person who's familiar with the moons, they'd quickly be able to pick out which moon that they're looking at. Each moon is very distinctive in its own right in terms of its particular characteristics that it has. Now, perhaps Tom might be able to make some comments here on the...
Yeah, well, I think I would say the same thing. I'm not sure that I agree with the premise of the question. I think the moons are quite distinctive. They appear to have been shaped by very different processes, in some cases processes that we don't understand at this point.
That's right.
There are some systematics in terms of size of the moon and the type of structure you see. There are also systematics with distance from planet and distance of planet from sun. But they're anomalies. Miranda is certainly an anomaly.
It's a strange world.
It's close to Saturn and very small, and it shows properties that, particularly for the small size, I think you would not expect.
Certainly, a few weeks ago, comparing the moons of Uranus, we'd more or less say, well, this would be more or less the same. They're points of light. We don't really know what they're like. And now that we're starting to see pictures of the surface of them, they're starting to become distinctive. They're going to have, some are going to be more sort of smooth around. For example, Titania, which is the largest of the moons of Uranus, and it looks relatively smooth. But then Miranda is a totally different kind of a world. It's much rougher.
Plus, the other three worlds, the pictures haven't come back yet.
Right. Yeah, but they, even the distant pictures, they look quite different from each other.
Yeah,
I think we're going to have great fun trying to understand all this for a long time to come.
And also, we were looking at the raw images. Wait till the computers get a crack at it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, hope that answered your question.
Right, yes, thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Good evening, thanks for phoning.
Yes, I was wondering, after the Voyager reaches Neptune and takes pictures of it and stuff, what will happen to it after? Is it going to keep going on and on?
On and on. I guess it's in orbit around our the center of the galaxy, just like any other star.
And will we be able to keep contact with it, or...?
For a while,
as long as its power systems still operate.
Yeah.
But as it gets further and further away from us, its signal is going to get weaker, and it's going to be harder for us to pick up that signal.
Yeah.
They hope to follow it at least until the year 2000.
Also, I was too young to remember, but when the Voyager was launched, were there not two of them?
Yes, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2.
What happened to the first one?
Went by Jupiter. It was the first one by Jupiter, first one by Saturn. But to get to see Titan, it had to go low, and there's a slingshot effect. So as it went low underneath Saturn, it was pushed up out of the plane of the solar system. Voyager 2 came around it and went around the side of Saturn so that it could stay in the plane of the solar system and move on to Uranus.
So Voyager 1 is sort of floating.
It's gone.
still have contact
with it, but it's gone. The interesting thing, too, is Voyager has very small rockets, but not big rockets to, after Saturn, push it off to Uranus and then push it off to Neptune. It's all gravitational assisted, so it's just the trajectory, which has to be very precise and has been, is mathematically was determined that it had to be in a certain spot to move on to the next planet.
So how long do you think it'll take to get to Neptune?
Well, August 1989, it'll be there.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
It's interesting to realize that the predictions for when Voyager 2 is going to fly by Uranus were very, very accurate. 4.5 years ago, when the first prediction was made, they said it was going to be 1 o'clock mm-hmm. on January 24th. It was going to be the closest approach.
Yeah.
And they were accurate to within 1 minute and 9 seconds.
Yeah,
Via Rail should do so well.
We're in trouble. Good evening. Thanks for calling.
Yes. Well, thanks for sharing this event with us. Considering the vast distance between the Sun and Uranus, what's the relative light level being utilized? Or in other words, if we were there, what would be the light level on Earth that we would compare to?
It's very low. If I remember the figure right, it's about 3/1,000ths of the light level at the Earth, something like that. They're taking 4-second exposures of the planet, which means they have to turn the spacecraft as they're taking the exposure so they don't blur the picture. It's a very difficult job out there because of that.
I guess from their location, too, the Sun really would just appear as a bright star, the brightest star that's in the sky.
Yeah.
But this is a bright star.
So a light level, like on your hand, would be what, like candlelight?
Cloudy day. No, less than that. Moonlight,
less,
maybe.
Less moonlight, yeah.
Moonlight. Full moonlight.
That's incredible.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, you're welcome. One thing I wanted to say about those really fantastic Miranda pictures is the spacecraft actually, as you said, did have to turn, just the same way that if you're taking a picture at a race and you have to turn to freeze the car and the background looks smeared. That's what it had to do, not quite as fast. The engineering involved was just incredible, and it was... They started working on it several years ago, and look at the fruits of their efforts.
It was even more difficult than you might think, because when they built the spacecraft, the camera was on a platform that swiveled, and that platform got jammed in one of the axes when it flew by Saturn. So when they got to Uranus, they couldn't swivel like they wanted to, so they were a little bit like a man with a stiff neck. Instead of swiveling their head to follow what was going on, they had to turn the whole spacecraft to do this process, and that all had to be programmed into the computers because it couldn't be done, they couldn't do it in real time because it takes 2 hours and 45 minutes to send a command out there.
That's right.
An
everything was programmed.
Piece of engineering.
Good evening.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes, first of all, I would like to say that I enjoy watching your show. And I would like to know, I have three questions here.
We'll take one question. We've got a few other calls, and we're nearly out of time.
Okay,
give
then.
Give us your best question.
Okay, approximately, how fast does the camera travels and the satellite?
Okay, the Voyager 2 right now is receding Uranus at 33,000 miles an hour, and right now it's just about 1,000,000 miles past Uranus. That's much faster, but much faster than a rifle bullet, for sure.
Okay, how do you determine what name to give to these planets and the moons?
That is an international group of astronomers which will have to do that sometime in the near future. Okay?
Thank you very much,
Thank
then.
You. Good evening. Thanks for calling.
Hello, my name is Jeff Leitner.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi. My first question is...
One question, please.
Oh, one question. Okay, I'll take the simplest question. Why is Uranus green?
Good question.
It's because the atmosphere has a lot of methane in it, and methane absorbs light very strongly in the red part of the spectrum. So the light that's reflected is basically light in the green and blue part of it and gives it a greenish tinge.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Goodbye.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thanks for calling.
Oh, good evening. How are you?
Good.
I'd like to direct a question to Dr. Bolton. And I'd like Dr. Bolton to know that this is a joint question from Beaton, Weinberg, and Semenik. And we're asking Dr. Bolton...
It sounds like a familiar group.
That's right. We'd like Dr. Bolton to give us a couple of his theories or opinions on the compositions of the rings and whether or not we might expect a similar composition with some of the dark or low albedo features we've been seeing on some of the satellites.
That's a very interesting question. I really don't have any theories, but they're so dark that they almost must be made out of very carbon-rich material, I think, and that seems to be the leading candidate for some of these black spots you see on the moons. I think a real question is where these rings came from and when they came to be there. It's not at all clear to me that the rings have been there since the formation of the planet. They may be the result of some kind of breakup of one or more moons, and after you've said that, I don't know where you go with what we know right now.
I see.
I'll see you guys on Tuesday.
Well, we'd also like to know if all this new influx of information is likely to result in any new jobs for astronomy undergrads.
Well, I don't know about astronomy undergrads, but...
Maybe on Miranda.
Maybe on Miranda.
Okay, thanks
first
very
astronaut court.
Hang on for graduate school. I think there's hope.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Bye. 30 seconds. What's your question?
I'd like to know, like, you know that it takes about 76 years for Comet Halley to go around the solar system.
Yes, sir.
Out of those 76 years, how many years is it when the comet reaches Uranus?
Oh, the comet goes out past Uranus, and I guess...
Past Neptune.
Past Neptune.
Beyond Pluto.
Within 30 years, okay?
Okay, thank
Thanks.
You.
Thanks. Okay, any summary? Any feelings? Extremely excited watching the pictures come in today.
I think that's our major feeling right now. It's fantastic seeing these pictures coming in. The marvel of science that this Voyager spacecraft, so many years after launch, is saying about this fantastic information. And we're going to be learning a lot more over the next while. Tom?
I'd say stay tuned for future happenings. We've just gotten a flavor of what's coming in. The best is yet to come, not only in additional pictures, but hearing about the thinking that's going on about the pictures. Stay tuned for 2, 3, 4 more years.
Great. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for being with me tonight. Thanks very much to Scott Tremaine in Pasadena for giving us his insights. My name's Randy Attwood with the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. To finish off tonight, we're going to play the music from Holt's The Planets. This happens to be Uranus over the credits, the magician. Clear skies, everyone. Enjoy the pictures. They're still coming in.